all these years. Blood, sweat, and tears, but I'm still here. Nothing can stop me. Run it up, run it up, run it up, run it up, run it up. Nothing can stop me.
Welcome, Groshoians, back to the number one resource on the planet to get yourself to 50 million plus. My name's Scott Scoia. I'm here with my partners in growth, Eric Watkins and Jeff Winters, and we are bringing the heat today. Couldn't be more fired up. And as Eric would say, let's let it rip.
Let's let it rip, baby.
Let it rip.
Jeff, how's the LinkedIn landscape looking these days?
The pasture. The sound effects are back.
So hard last week. They're probably in now. I haven't listened to last week yet. I know it just came out, but oh, look at that. A little overflow sound effect. I like that. But they were put in afterwards.
He didn't get to do them last week. He's making up for lost time.
Got a really nice comment email from a listener. Mm-hmm. And just like loves the different segments. That feels good.
Yeah.
It's the good. It's a good vibe. It's a different vibe. And this segment in specific, for our loyal listeners, you know it. For our new listeners, I'm going through LinkedIn. We're just looking for stuff that's right and stuff that's not, and we're making sure that it's you know, a little more decipherable for all you out there. All right, first from Ronnie C. I'm just not saying his Ronnie's last name because it doesn't have it. Hot take. Negative comments in your ads, and I'm going to add parenthetically, in your posts, are a good sign. It means you got their attention. Truth.
I would agree with that as well.
Right?
If everybody agrees with what you're saying, you're just kind of doing the status quo of what the general population is saying. You're just regurgitating what you're hearing. People aren't disagreeing. I don't think it's original.
I'm slow today. What you're saying, if someone has a negative comment on your post.
Yeah,
you on your post or your, well. Oh, sorry. Well, he said ad. So on LinkedIn, you know, they have ads and then you can comment on the ads.
Okay.
And I think people are looking for like roses and flowers and like, oh, this is a great free white paper. But like sometimes people are like, you suck.
This thing sucks. Oh,
yeah.
Got it. All right.
This is a LinkedIn comment on LinkedIn ads.
Yeah. I mean, you're going to always have the competition that's going to disagree with you. Yeah, I agree. It got attention is what you're saying.
Yeah. All
that's a truth.
This comes from a former employee, Dave Brashears, who is thoughtful and smart on the topic of sales. And this just hit home because we just did this and it really worked. How you allocate sales territories to reps and SDRs based on geography, industry vertical, market segment, or product use case, and in what quantities may be seriously impeding your pipeline generation efforts. Some people are better at selling certain industries and certain geographies. The person that can cold call or sell in Nashville might not be as good at selling in New York. This is something where you could move the trees around a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
This is good. This is second level type insights.
Yeah, I agree. And with changes like this, you don't have to get any better, work any harder. It just naturally happens. Yeah. So like taking advantage of these as much as you can, I think is a huge deal for your business.
I've always been a big believer in, you know, there's riches in the niches. And when you're living in an arena, whether it be in an industry or in a territory, you know, you're just going to get better at prospecting or selling. Like forever, we had to figure out who to send to the middle of New York City, right? Because it's just a different prospect and a different buying cycle, and you got to have the right personality matchup. I love this, and he's smart.
He's smart, dude,
from a sales process perspective.
That's right.
And think about, you know, the people might be in a similar situation to where we were in, where we lost a couple reps, right? Mm-hmm. And you're sitting there trying to figure out, well, how do you make the quota add up? Without adding any new reps, we ended up in a spot where we are selling way more revenue than we were the month before, simply just by doing this.
Yep. Truth.
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 I'm going to get hate on this one. people are going to hate.
From us?
No, because what I'm about to say, most people at work think is a truth, and it is not. And people don't like this. This is people get really pissed off.
Is this that you should leave your car running for the whole day?
I did leave my car running yesterday, which is horribly embarrassing. From Anessa. Spicy Sunday. I think this is a lie, and I think this gets businesses in trouble. I am getting really tired of seeing people who haven't been in the day-to-day trenches, like doing the job in like 5 or 10 years, telling others and teaching others how to do the job. If this is you, know that most of us in the space that are still like practitioners see through you. It's glaring. So here's why I think this is a lie. And I have seen this a lot in this last year. There is a beauty to detachment. You being detached and not being in the trenches gives you a perch to give advice. And I'm sorry, people in the trenches. I'm sorry, frontline leaders. This gets people in trouble because the detachment is beauty. You can just see shit that the... I'll let Scott go from here, but there is a beauty in the detachment.
What does that mean?
I just feel like you've had some really, as you've gotten a little more detached and not been as in the day-to-day, you see things that I don't see and that frontline people don't see and can't see.
Yeah. Look, there's a reason that deer stands exist, right? Get your way up and way out so that you can see your target, make it easier to...
Are you a hunter now?
Get your prey.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I wouldn't, no offense to all you deer hunters, but that's the most boring shit I've ever done in my life. Have you ever done it?
No.
You literally sit there for 4 hours freezing your balls off until you, and then never see anything. And then you do it like, yeah. Sorry, stray. Yeah. This one, if the further away I get, the easier it is to see a process falling down or a person that shouldn't be in a job or that's why you looked at me, isn't it?
Yeah, there's beauty in detachment.
I might be guilty of being a little more detached and having a little more advice people hate, but the person that is not doing it every day, I feel like has a different window in that's valuable.
Agree. I would say the middle ground, though, would be the person who's removed that also pops in the trenches for a little bit to get a view and perspective and to get insights from people, because then that's where the magic happens.
You gotta go see.
Yeah.
Go see.
Yeah.
Go see.
But 100%.
Yeah.
We got a little episode called Get Your Ass Back in Your Business that kind of dives into that.
Yep. But
sometimes you gotta get back in the weeds and throw elbows and do the work to see if what you were seeing is accurate, for sure.
Yeah. Bonus lie on the deer hunting, not to digress, but like, you go, how was your deer hunting day? It was amazing. How many deer did you see? None. How was it amazing?
Because they're wasted, which is a whole nother problem.
I don't think some of them are. I think some of them just love
sitting
in that stand.
Read a book and sat in the cold at 4. Maybe I don't get it.
I think that the deer hunters are listening and saying,
we're going to lose some viewers over there.
They're saying, you guys are idiots. Like, I'm away from everyone in a stand. Yeah. I don't have to listen to anyone.
I see that.
That's what they're thinking.
Yeah. I take it back. I'm down with deer
hunting. It's the same reason why your neighbor's out mowing his yard 3 times a week.
Wouldn't you rather golf?
I'd rather do anything. First of all, the mowing your yard to be away from your family thing. That's 6-1. I don't want to mow the yard to be away.
you're picking another activity.
Yeah, I got something else. All right. Back to you, Scott.
Okay. There's a state of mind that you need to be in to break down barriers and do things that others thought were once not possible. We've gone through different stages of this recently where there's a certain economic climate that we're all in, or we just went through a horrible pandemic, right? Or we're growing our business and we're striving for bigger growth numbers than we've had, higher retention rates, bigger sales numbers. And you all that are listening know what I'm talking about. If you want to do something that's never been done before, you have probably been surrounded by people that query the data and show you why increasing close rates by 7.5% are completely unreasonable, or growing your business by 37% this year when you've only done 11 or 12 in your history, it's completely unreasonable, or making your product do something that nobody's ever done. Steve Jobs, perfect example, in saying that, you know, he wants people to be able to carry music around in the palm of their hands, right? And people are like, you're just freaking crazy. There's something to this, though, because if you, even if you're not saying what's in your head out loud, if you have any thought that it won't happen, it won't. Like, even if you're not taking that negative energy out of your head and telling it to anybody, you still have it in your head. Like, if we're in the middle of a pandemic and we're thinking that it's unreasonable to hit sales numbers because the world is locked down, versus this is the time people should buy our service so that they're ready when the pandemic clears, you know, you're in trouble. But this is hard, because if you've got a growth number and there's any part of your brain that thinks that maybe it's unreasonable or you won't hit it, you absolutely won't. So you've got to do whatever the hell it takes to get it out of your brain and be in this reality of, this is what's going to happen, we can do it. And then, more importantly, you got to surround yourself with people that feel that way. And if there's anyone that is on your team that doesn't think that that sales goal can happen, or your product development piece will come to fruition, then you're screwed and you're going to have to get them out of the way. And as you become a certain size business, as a leader, this is one of the most important things. Like, you're going to ask for unrealistic things where there is literally no data or no history or proof that you can make that happen. And you're going to have to lead people through that and believe in that and get the people out of the way that aren't along for the ride. That's my 50 for 50 for today. What do you guys think?
So, you know, you talked about this, and I'll expand on the story. So it's Steve Jobs is famous for what people called his reality distortion field. He felt, and I didn't know him, but dug in learning and trying to understand more about someone who's probably one of the greatest leaders in human history, what you find is that he just thought that, given work ethic and attitude and belief, that way more of life was malleable than others. And the story that we talked about in pre-production was when he was trying to get the mouse to go in multiple, like all four directions or something, and somebody who reported to him said it couldn't be done. They fired him, like, on the spot. And that guy probably was not a dummy. That guy probably didn't right. get paid zero. That guy probably went to a good college, and they fired him. Like, that is how, and then they hired a guy, and the guy's first words were, "I can build the mouse." And if Steve Jobs does it that way, then, you know, what does that mean for you and your business?
I feel like we've had time periods where we wanted to do something and there was no data to suggest that we could. And sometimes there were people in the way that absolutely, beyond a shadow of a doubt, did not believe that we could hit those numbers or do those things. And it took pushing that person or those people to the side to actually have reality.
Get there. I feel like the cheat code here is, like, to me, I'm a logical person. So this isn't always easy for me. I look at it. I like numbers. I look at the numbers. But I think you just take the numbers and you create the story. So, okay, we need to be 50% better than we ever were before. And we're at 16% now. But if we got 34% better in this specific area, that's all we need to do. We're there. Or break it down into smaller goals. And I think that can help you get people bought into the message more than just being like, yep, we got to hit this standard that we haven't hit before. And I know it's difficult, but you guys got it. And I believe it's easy. We can make it happen. I think when you break it down into that, it makes it even easier to believe it.
This is something you said to me, Eric, last year when I wasn't, you know, we talk about when we're not doing so well on this show. Like, I wasn't hitting my goals last year. And you were like, hell, somebody could do it. I was like, you know what? So he's like, it's not you right now, but somebody could do it. So, like, why the fuck isn't you? He's like, because somebody could come in here and do this. Like, it's not impossible. And I feel like it's different to say it can be done versus somebody could do it. Because yeah. I thought about that every day all year. I was like, fuck, somebody could do it. I'm just missing something. And then we corrected it. But somebody could have done it.
And we may or may not have had some obstacles in the way where we were hitting one number and now hitting another number in a couple of departments, right? It's just, we're not sitting here talking about these topics all the time because we are always getting it right.
Right.
Like, we're bringing these things up because when we do, they work, and when we don't, we get punched in the face, and that's when you have your reminder and you try to not do it again. But you're out there listening, and there is something going on. You are elevating your service, or you're striving for a growth number, or you're retaining clients at a different level, or expecting a different customer satisfaction rate. And maybe the data doesn't exist to suggest that you'll do it. So, like Eric says, go run the numbers and put your strategy in place. And then if the numbers don't exist, which also happens sometimes, sure, then it's just, they just got to believe with you. And they got to care so much about what it would look like if you were there, that everyone is swinging elbows as a team to make sure that you get there. It's always possible.
Yep.
It is always possible. So, all right. We are headed to Mining for Growth School. What do we got today, Eric?
You got to let it breathe. Oh, one more. Ah, see, I'm not used to it. We cut it out last week. Quick story on the last section. I remember when I was first a partner success manager, managing accounts, managing people, my first 3 months in the position, you know, I had all these cancels, and my mind would just go to, well, that was sold with the wrong expectations, or they shouldn't have canceled, or that was the account manager before me. Then all of a sudden one day I woke up and I was like, is any of that making me any better? Like, are any of those thoughts serving me in any way? Like, right. Does it change anything? No. Like, maybe it helps my ego feel better because I can justify it. But that's where I came up with, I was like, somebody wouldn't have lost that client. And then it keeps you focused on, it's like the North Star.
Yeah.
To like, continue to beat yourself up and get better and better and better. Beat yes. yourself up in a good way. All right. Anyway, Mining for Growth Gold today. So we've talked and alluded to this in the past, and in some things I feel like I skip over because they're so ingrained in our culture. But when I take myself outside of it at other businesses where you're doing prospecting, it may not be so common. It may not be something that you're really looking at. But 35 to 40% of all the appointments we set are people that either told us no or not right now, what we would call our nurture leads. 35 to 40%. So if you think about that, if we're closing 500,000 in recurring sales for our sales team, 200 to 250 of those told us no or not right now at one point in time. And I think people make two mistakes. You have the first group where people just give up on them altogether. Oh, they have a company that they're working with, not a fit. Put them to the side. Never call them again. Never email them again. Some clients even go out on their first meeting or have their first presentation or discovery meeting and find that out, and then they never do any sort of follow-up. So you're missing out on half your sales right there. Second mistake is I think they push them out too long. I think people underestimate how much change happens in business. And the time frame we use is 90 days. And even in some periods, depending on how the no interest or not right now call went, we'll even follow up sooner than that. So what I would say is, A, you absolutely have to follow up even if they're not interested, whether that's in the sales process or in the process of trying to get to an appointment. And then B, you need to set a maximum of 90 days. I don't care if the person told you, unless they said, do not ever call me again, that's probably where you suspend that one, because you got to honor that and not call them again. But if they just say, no, I'm not interested at all, I have a company, I'm calling that person back in 90 days, because so many things change and that person may not even be at that company anymore. That's the tip. That's it. Keep that time frame 90 days. Don't go outside of that. Stay within it.
I mean, I love it. I love nurture. We've talked about this a lot. I feel like our product, when we come into a marketplace, isn't looked at enough as a tool where you are building relationships over time with the only companies that matter. And one day when somebody comes into the sales cycle, whether they're, I don't know, using a managed service provider for the first time, or they don't like the service of their existing one and want to switch, they're going out for, you know, proposal review, you'll be the one that's there. And the clients that are with us for the long haul, they eventually end up seeing that. You know, that sale where we had 72 contacts over three years of in a variety of ways, calls, emails, voicemails, things like that. Like, how can it not work?
Right? Becomes too big to fail. Like, yeah. Your pipeline actually becomes too big to fail if you continuously follow up until they're ready.
I'll tell you how it doesn't work. Womp womp. Most people's nurtures suck. You know what most people's nurtures are? It's like an email once a quarter about like your family trip. And I just wanted to, or like some white paper once a quarter that's going to 90% spam. That is lazy. You can do that too, but that is lazy. They go, oh, people get off this podcast and go, they go to their head of marketing and go, we got to get that nurture going. Oh, I got the nurture. I'm going to send out an email once a newsletter. That is not nurturing. That is lazy. Call the people. That's what you got to do. You can do the other stuff too. The other stuff's great.
Right.
You got to call. Pick up the phone.
Call the people.
Call the people.
They're so put off by the no up front.
Mm-hmm.
And they should be okay if someone says no, as long as it's a qualified company, like Eric's saying, then that's part of your network going forward. And maybe you never sell them, but then they're out on a Saturday and someone's looking for a new commercial cleaning company, and even though they don't need it, they tell their buddy, hey, this person's been calling me, they've been great, we don't do business with them, but they've been very pleasant, they've been following up for a couple of years, give them a try.
Shout out ADP. Hooked us up with some crumble cookies. Got Scott to open the FedEx letter, got the crumble cookies. We don't need ADP right now. We're probably not buying from them. Maybe we don't ever buy from them. I don't know. But Scott may be like, someone mentioned something about ADP and he's like, they sent me a box of crumble cookies. Like,
seriously. Yeah,
I know. Like, that could come out in conversation easily.
That's not lazy. That's smart.
Cassie almost runs into the room when Eric and I are talking, and there's a FedEx envelope and crumble cookies. She's like, I didn't know if there was a check in here or something. It looks important. And kudos to her. It could have been.
Yeah.
It's like, here you go. And we open it up. You know, the ADP FedEx is me a letter about seeing our ad for a payroll position and sends the crumbled cookies, which are really good. Thank you.
Oh, God.
So good.
Oh,
And you're right. If someone was looking for payroll services, even though maybe we, like, we just have a decent enough size of accounting department, we prefer to do that internally. But does not mean that they don't have incredible services. And if I run into somebody that's looking for it, I probably do say, you know what? My crumble cookie says you should call ADP.
They're exactly. working that hard to get you. Imagine how hard they'll work to keep you.
Yep.
Yeah. It's a good example. Mm. Awesome. So, Jeff, what do we hear from sales? Tales from sales.
Very tactical, very specific, but a tactic that is so tried and true and works incredibly well. So, Eric, I'm going to put you on the spot.
Okay.
So, I am at the New Balance store 4 days ago. I'm cool. I like New Balance shoe. That's a cool shoe.
Do you wear it? I've never seen you in a pair of New Balance.
Just, neither here nor there. I wear it to work out, exercise.
Yeah.
Right? And I'm doing P90X3. Shout out Tony Horton. Shout out P90X3. Shout out to all you all doing it on your TV. It's awful, but it's great. And I go to the New Balance store. And I'm looking at these shoes. And there's one shoe that's $220. And there's one shoe that's $120. And I go, I'm doing P90X, obviously. Because I'm shredded after 4 weeks of doing it. Not really at all. And I go, what should I buy? Which one of these shoes? What do most salespeople say? You got $225 shoe and $125 shoe. What do most salespeople say?
$225.
Buy the expensive one.
Yeah.
He said, man, I got to be honest with you. I'd buy that one. What would I not let? Would I let that guy babysit my kids for the week? Is he the most trustworthy person I've ever met in my life now? Because he downsold me $100. Oh, Scott's got a different opinion. I'm so excited. He's like, dude.
On New Balance, I do.
Yeah.
Oh, no. But like on the sales tactic of
right,
like.
Right, 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 right.
I'm so, now I trust this guy. Because I know in my head and in my heart, I'm like, this guy. Doesn't he's not in for himself. He actually is an expert. He's like, it's just, it's wobbly and the ankle and all this stuff, don't do it. I'm like, whatever you want. Like I tried to hire this guy I tried to hire this guy to work here. I will never buy a shoe without consult if I can. And so here's the lesson. Look for an opportunity to do this in your sales call. We had a call yesterday. The guy goes, look, we just hired another vendor. Should we run you two side by side in this small city? Easy for me to say yes. I said, nope, don't do it. Why not? I said, because it's just not good for you. We'll run into each other. We have to coordinate. It's just not good. It's a small town. Don't do it. He's like, okay, what if I chose a big city to run you in? Bang. Bang. This happens all the time. And I never get that question if I don't say no. And he just said, I love your energy. Look for the opportunity to do something not in your self-interest. It will pay dividends. That is the lesson.
Like that.
I believe in it wholeheartedly. I didn't mean to poo-poo on your New Balance story. I'm just thinking about the $220 New Balance shoe that's like your feet are in the clouds.
That's what it is.
Huh?
It's what it is. It's so cushiony.
Oh my God, it's so good. I'm thinking about running. When I did run longer distances, I went with that shoe, and there, you know, you're just so much pounding and so much distance. That shoe was amazing. But I love that. I love that. It's all, and in combination with almost the takeaway, right? It's like you're not trying to sell me something, or you're not trying to sell me more, and then I trust you, and then I probably spend more.
That's right.
I think it goes to it. This trails over to the account management side too, of, you know, when we ask clients, you know, on a scale of 1 to 5, how are you feeling about the long term of this partnership? They're like, really, I'm feeling like a 4. Honestly, if I were you, I wouldn't be a 4 right now.
There you go.
Like, I would be a 2, and here's why, but here's what we're going to do about it to move it forward. Like, it's that, like, just being honest.
Yeah,
like extremely transparent through the process.
Like, really, if it was going exactly the way that it's going right now, we would do business forever. Well, maybe not. That's what I thought.
Find people that are generally skeptical and mistrusting by nature. They will tell you, people say that, I'm very skeptical by nature. I don't trust people easily. And then shock them with telling them to do something that is not in your self-interest, and watch how quickly they start asking your opinion. Is that too in the weeds?
No, that's good. All that's right. Good stuff.
Shout out New Balance.
New sponsor.
New sponsor.
Future sponsor. No free sponsors.
It is a great shoot for sure. All right, we're going to Eric's favorite section. Maybe nobody else's. Hey, by the way, in the nice message from the client,
he loves it
too. No, he said this wasn't his favorite section at the end.
I didn't read it that way.
Oh no, I thought he liked the banter.
He loves the banter, but he was clearing it up that he said, to be clear, I did not say that to do or not to do was my favorite section. Huh. I'm just kidding. Was walking around my neighborhood laughing out loud, but I did not say it was my favorite section.
Oh yeah, he did correct us.
But he liked it.
I think it might I think it might be his favorite.
Sometimes you gotta knock Eric down. He's like got this enormous head about to do or not to do. Like it's the only part of the podcast that anyone should listen to.
This one, I'm gonna need you guys to imagine a little bit on this one. Because I'm not sure if it applies because your houses may be too big. But me, in my small house, compacted with next to a bunch of different houses, there's this thing that goes on in the morning, right? I'm on the main road. So when I come out of my driveway, when I'm backing out of my driveway, there's a car typically coming around the turn. And it's sort of this feel of like, should I reverse out? I know I could get ahead of this person before I, because the road, it's not easy to turn onto. So, you know, I got to make the decision. Do I wait, you know, 15 seconds for this guy to come around and let him go just to be polite? Or like, I could probably get out, but he may have to put on his brakes a little bit to go. Yeah, I know. Well, you didn't have a choice because you were backed up to a main road, so you'd be in a car accident if you did. Jeff, I think your houses may be a little too spread out. But is that rude? Like, I feel like I'm not that my job's more important than their job, but I just feel like I got to get there a little quicker than what they're doing today, than taking their kids to elementary school or whatever. Is that wrong?
I mean, they didn't have to slam on their brakes.
Yeah, right? They're not slamming on. No,
they saw you. They see you backing out. They have to slow down a little bit.
Some people are so overly polite, it makes me sensitive about it. Like, some people will wait for like a day that you're cleared and you already made the turn on the road, and then they're backing up.
I think you're backing out of the driveway.
You think I'm fine? Yeah, I'm fine.
This is some small city shit right here. That's what this is. We've come down with a case of small city-itis. Because let me tell you something. There is a direct correlation with how people feel about this and how big your city is. Because in Miami, they ain't waiting. Slam on the brakes, too much. I want you to touch the bumper. In Columbia, Illinois, wait an hour.
O'Fallon.
Whatever.
You can, and in Jeff's neighborhood, you can't see a car for like a mile.
You could land a plane in between cars leaving the neighborhood.
Have to get past the helicopter pad.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And the gate and the guards. But I'm telling you, I don't operate that way.
I don't either. And I'm not offended when someone does it to me either.
That's the rule. No double standards.
When I'm on 40 or 44 and I speed and someone like pops right in front of me, you know what I say? I'm not saying F you. I'm like, nice move,
right?
That's what I'm doing when I'm driving. I'm like, I would have done that. I had a little opening. Nice
shouldn't have left the space.
Nice. I gotta give
shouldn't
it
have
to
left
you
the space there.
I feel no road rage ever. That is not an emotion that I
when
feel.
Somebody tail we talked about
you
the
can't
other
have road rage when you're going 42 miles
yeah
an hour.
In the far right lane.
And I don't
We showed you with statistics that is
you have a higher
dangerous
likelihood of dying than we do.
Yeah.
I feel no road rage.
I don't like getting tailgated. That's my thing. We talked about it.
Yeah, and Scott, what did you do to that poor guy?
You know what? You're getting
hours
tailgated, you tap on the brakes.
Yeah, you tap on the brakes.
You give him a little
you
scare.
You take him down a back road in Iowa.
Can I just say one thing, totally off topic, and then we can jump?
Yes.
I've had this dog, Anybody following the show, I got a dog. I swear on my life, I'm a week in. We're $450 into vet bills. 1 week. At this pace, I'm going to spend $1.2 million on this dog.
This is your fault.
Four?
That's a different
thing. How is that possible? Who? Yeah,
all
right.
We all knew it was, coming your way. We knew that you would be millions into this dog. We knew it.
Good Lord.
This dog makes more than...
I got pet insurance today. I just got pet insurance.
Did you? You got pet insurance?
Another $50 a month. We can get out of here. I just wanted everyone to know that.
No, next.
Do you have life insurance in case the Hawk Guard doesn't work?
Shout out Hawk Guard. Shout out to the Hawk Guard. Come get my, try to come get my puppy.
If you're out there and you own a vet hospital, we will post Jeff's number. He's a he's
future sponsor.
Yes, for sure. Thank you for listening. As always, keep the comments and suggestions coming. If you need help with your growth and we can be there for you, we'd love to partner. Otherwise, we just love being in the conversation. We hope we're helpful. Let's grow.
Let's grow.
Let's grow.
Let it rip.
Let it rip. The Grow Show is sponsored by Creative Suites. Big agency flavor, bite-size price.